So last time we had introduced this general notion, notation for multi-component conduit trees. So let me write down the action again in the compact notation. So this psi has corresponds to n separate spinners. Okay, so there are 4n components. So each psi carries two index. Okay, one is the alpha index, that's the spinner index. The other one is what we call I. Okay, that's the index that runs over n values. And then we said that this has a symmetry. This is invariant. Under psi goes to u psi. Okay, by u dagger u. Identity. You can either think of U as an n by n unitary matrix, arbitrary n by n unitary matrix, or as a 4n by 4n matrix, but then each element is basically identity, okay, 4 by 4 identity matrix. Okay. But I'll just write it in this way. Okay. In components, you have to keep in mind that this U acts only on the I index of psi. Okay. The alpha index just doesn't see the action of U. Okay, that's the notation, but I'll try to be more abstract and write the transformation this way. Okay, I'll not try to explain at every stage where the matrices act. Okay, it should be clear from the way I'm writing it. Gamma mu's, of course, on the other hand, act on the alpha beta index. Right? They don't see the I j index. Okay, they will act on the alpha beta index. Okay, so now the question that we want to ask is, is it possible to make this Lagrangian, okay, or an action? So let me write it as an action, an integral x. Is it possible to make this somehow asymmetric under psi of x onto u of x and psi of x? So what is u of x? This is still a unitary matrix, ux dagger ux is identity. This is true for every x, but in general we will want to allow u to depend on x. Okay, so as you go from one point to a neighboring point, the matrix u that I am choosing can change, but of course preserving this condition that u is still a unitary matrix. So this means that each component of u can be a function of x, but they have to satisfy this condition that tells us that u dagger u is identity. Is this clear? So now let's see if this action is invariant under this transformation. So the action that we have written goes to integral psi bar I. So psi bar goes to psi bar u dagger. Because psi bar was psi dagger gamma 0. Psi dagger is psi dagger u dagger. Okay, that's clear. But then u, of course, commutes with gamma 0, right? They act on different spaces. So you commute u to gamma 0. So this is psi bar u dagger. Okay, gamma 0 just comes and acts on psi dagger. Then you have I gamma mu, then u minus m. U psi. So now we can simplify it a little. So this gives you integral psi bar u dagger gamma mu I u dagger gamma mu. Now this derivative will now act on u and psi, okay, because u is a space dependent object. So the first term will be del mu u times psi plus I u dagger gamma mu u del mu psi minus m u psi. Is this clear? Okay, I guess you replace psi by u psi, keeping in mind that the derivative can act on
u as well.
So this gives you integral psi bar I integral, let me write that I gamma mu integral del mu. Keeping in mind that u dagger and gamma mu. Cyber I have kept outside. Oh, yes, thank you. Look at this u dagger, otherwise I could have kept the u dagger. So this is okay, I just passed the u dagger through the gamma mu. Here, we see that this u dagger passes through gamma mu, and then I use the fact that u dagger u is identity. So this is just I gamma mu then mu psi minus, then again u dagger u is identity, so minus a psi. Is this clear? So these two terms are the right ones. These are what you want. But this we see is an extra piece similar to what we had for electrodynamics. Right? In quantum electrodynamics, we started by writing psi bar I gamma mu del mu minus m psi. Okay, and you made a phase transformation. Okay, then made the phase dependent on x, and then we found that we have an extra piece left over, which then cancels against the transformation of the gauge field. So this is the analog of that extra piece, except that these are now matrices. Okay? If u was just e to the I alpha of x, a simple phase, then this would be exactly what we had gotten in quantum electrodynamics. Del mu psi, thank you. Yeah, sorry. Well, I can write the psi. So what we are going to do is to try to repair it by introducing an extra field that will be the analog of the gauge field that we encountered in QED. Okay. And as I need an appropriate transformation law, an appropriate coupling to psi, so that this term gets cancelled. Okay. Just like in QED, okay, we had coupled psi bar gamma mu mu psi, there is a coupling, and then mu goes to mu plus del mu epsilon, cancel the unwanted term. Okay. So we try to do something similar there. Okay. Again, let me emphasize that why you want to construct a theory with this property, that of course nobody tells you that you have to have a theory with this property. Okay. But it so happens that the nature is described by theories of this kind, okay, which has symmetries, local symmetries of the kind that I am considering here. Okay. But right now our goal is to see if it is possible to build a theory which has symmetries of this kind, okay, where the transformation of psi transforms to a unitary matrix times psi, but the unitary matrix is dependent on the space-time points. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll try to remedy this by replacing del mu psi by d mu psi. And d mu psi will be del mu psi in analogy with what we had for, let me put the signs correctly, minus I s mu psi. Okay. So what is s mu? S mu is an n by n matrix. That acts on the I index. Okay, so S mu psi means it's actually a matrix multiplying psi. Okay, but this matrix acts on the I space, not on the alpha space. Okay. So in components, I can write the d mu psi, I don't remember if I wrote the I index first or alpha index first, but doesn't matter. I'll not write that alpha index at all. Okay. K is del mu psi k minus I S mu A L psi. So these are new fields that I'm going to introduce. Is this clear? This will be the analog of the electromagnetic field, the AMU, that we had in QED. Okay. But now I'm introducing a set of gauge fields, not a single gauge field, which you can either think of as a matrix whose each component is a field. And that's what it means. S mu KL is a KL element of this matrix, and that's a field by itself. Okay. So at this stage, you have introduced n square fields. Okay. And I have not told you whether these are complex fields or real fields. So let's take them to be complex in general. Okay. So n square complex fields or 2n square real fields. Okay, that's what I've introduced so far. Okay, you see, because this I, we don't know a priori whether this is real or complex or whatever, right? So let's be most general, allow it to be complex.
So, when you had this 4n by 4n
yes.
formulation, now
are we
going back to the, by separating alpha?
Yeah, by separating alpha, so you can always think of these as 4n by 4n matrix, right? By putting S mu on each, multiplying S mu by identity, right? That's always the case, right? So when I, if I write in components, of course, then there's a confusion, right? I mean, I can write a K alpha,
yeah.
Right? This will be K alpha and this will be L alpha, right? The alpha index is not touched by this multiplication. Okay, but it should be obvious from the way I'm writing it, right? The Dirac indices will be carried only by the gamma mu's, right? Or products of gamma mu's, right? Everything else that I'm writing, okay? Are carrying the IJ index, but not the Dirac index. Any other questions? So what is the goal now? We want to see how to transform S mu. Okay, we have not said how S mu transforms under gauge transforms. Okay. Obviously, you have to give some transformation of S mu. And our goal will be to transform S mu in such a way that this one transforms covariantly, okay, which means that this one gets multiplied by u. Okay. So you want d mu psi goes to u times d mu psi. If we can ensure this, then you can see we are done, right? Because we will replace this del mu by d mu. Okay. If d mu psi, so if under psi goes to u psi and whatever transformation we apply to s mu, if d mu psi goes to u times d mu psi, okay, then that u will combine with this u dagger and cancel it, right? It will become identity. Okay, so this is what we want. Once we have achieved this, we are done. Okay, we have gotten we can write down a Lagrangian, which is gauge invariant. Is this point clear? So let's suppose that psi goes to psi prime, okay, which is u psi. I'm just introducing notion of psi prime, and that S mu goes to S mu prime. Okay, we don't know what it is. Okay, we have to find S mu prime. Okay, that's the goal. Given this, let's see what becomes of this. So d mu psi then will go to del mu minus I S prime mu on u psi. So let me write psi prime. Okay, I have just written everything in the prime notation, but psi prime you already know is u psi. So this is del mu minus I S mu prime of u psi. And what you want is that this should be u times del mu minus res mu psi. Is this clear? Okay, because if this is equal to this, then when I replace del mu by d mu, the u will come to the left, okay, and it will cancel the u dagger. So the idea now is that we will just compare this with this to figure out what s prime mu is. Okay, we will demand s prime mu to be something that exactly cancels this, that exactly gets this. So this is not very hard because you calculate this. So this is u times del mu psi plus del mu u times psi minus I s prime mu psi. Sorry, as I s prime mu psi. I just multiply del mu, the first del mu of course acts on both u and psi, that is two terms, okay. And minus I s prime is just a matrix, so minus I s prime u psi, okay. And I will equate this to this, so this term cancels, right, u del mu psi with u del mu psi. Rest of the terms have no derivative on psi. Okay? So you can try to satisfy the equation by just stripping off psi from both sides. Okay? And think of this as an equation between matrices, okay? Between n by n matrices. So what we get is minus I u s mu equal to del mu u minus I s prime mu u. So this gives you s prime mu u. As so del mu u goes to the other side, so minus I del mu u plus u s u. Is clear? I just shifted this del mu u to the other side, okay, and multiply by I. So I get minus I del mu and then u s. So s prime mu is minus I del mu u times u inverse plus u s mu. And u inverse of course is the same as u dagger. Is this clear so far? Okay. So now we can also see that why you have to keep s mu complex, okay. Because if you started from a real s mu here, in general this will be complex. Okay. There are i's here, u is a unitary matrix, so it has complex numbers. Okay. So it wouldn't make sense to transform S mu to S mu prime, okay, if we had imposed a condition that S mu is real, right? Then S prime will also, be real, right? A real thing should transform to a real thing. Okay. So this tells us that we have to take S mu to be complex, okay? And that means there are n square complex variables that are there in S mu. So S mu as it stands, okay, describes an n square complex fields. Or 2n square real fields. Is this clear? So what we want to explore now is whether it is possible to do it less number of fields. Okay. if you choose 2n square complex, 2n square L fields, right, you can do this, because then a general, take a general matrix that would fill S mu, okay, obviously this transformation makes sense. Okay. And in the Lagrangian, if you now replace del mu by d mu, you will get a perfectly invariant action. But now the question is whether it is possible to do it less number of fields. Okay, what is the minimum number of fields if you can do it? Is this question clear?
No?
Yeah. So, as it stands, S mu has n square complex fields, right? N square elements, then each of them is a complex field. Now, the question is it possible to achieve what you want to achieve? Okay, which is this equation over here, the d mu psi, that it, that this should be equal to this, okay, with less number of fields, right? That you want to put some additional restriction on S mu, okay, but whatever additional restriction you put on S mu should be such that if the right hand side S mu satisfies the restriction, then the left hand side, this one, should automatically satisfy the restriction, right? Then this transformation makes sense. Right. Suppose you have put some restriction on S mu, and that restriction is obeyed by the transformed object, then we should be okay. Is this okay?
Why would you want to do that?
Because you want to introduce a minimal number of extra fields, right? I mean, you can of course always introduce extra fields, right? For example, in QVD, you could introduce mu to be a complex field, right? That would be two gauge fields. But you could manage it one gauge field, right? To make that covariant, just one gauge field would have been enough, right? So that's what you want to see, that what is the minimal number of fields with which you can achieve this.
Sir,
so,
we had n square for S. So how many constants does this equation put in this transformation law? Does it put constants?
Yeah, transformation law puts n square constants because it specifies each and every element of the transform matrix, right?
Yes.
So if you think of this as n square matrix, sorry, n by n complex matrix,
yeah,
right, it gives you n by n complex equations, right, n square complex equations, because each component, so this transformation law is unique, there is no ambiguity in what you have written here, right, okay, once I write it in the matrix notation, you just take a KL component and the KL component of the right hand side is also well defined, right, so it's not that the transformation law is ambiguous. But nevertheless, you want to see if it is possible to do it less number of fields.
Means, what I was asking was that this transformation law doesn't constrain my number of fields in any way.
No, this doesn't, because this is valid if you take S mu to be an n by n complex matrix, right? It gives a perfectly sensible answer for what S prime mu should be.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
No.
So,
but here U is arbitrary. You can take U as any matrix,
any unitary matrix. Yes.
And there is some freedom in this equation. You can choose inside that this equation can simplify in some manner.
Yes. So can simplify meaning this equation tells us that for you have to first specify what u is, right? U as a function of x.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Given u as a function of x, this equation tells us that given any initial S mu, the final S mu is given by this formula over here. Okay. So there is no freedom here, right? Because this determines all the components of S mu. The transformed S mu. But nevertheless, it may be possible that you may be able to do it less. Okay? Yes.
Does that argument have to do something with the Lagrangian condition or not? Because when we are doing electrodynamics,
yes,
where did we argue that the A has to be, A mu has to be real? Like A mu that comes about.
Yes. Well, it doesn't have to do with this being Hermitian. You can always add back its complex conjugate. If the Lagrangian turns out to be not invariant, not real, right?
Yes. Do not need in any case an extra term to restore the Hermiticity of Lagrangian, right? So now after you get the term,
yes,
you claim that there is invariance.
Yes.
Now if I check whether the Lagrangian is Hermitian or not,
yes,
then the emu star term, if it is not emu, then the Lagrangian is not Hermitian, right?
Well, you can always add something which is Hermitian, which makes it Hermitian, which is the Hermitian conjugate, right? See, we have constructed a Lagrangian which is invariant. Now, if it turns out to be not Hermitian, you just add the Hermitian conjugate, right? If the original action was invariant, then the Hermitian conjugate will also be invariant. So here, this is not the problem. We can always add back the Hermitian conjugate term. Okay, and it will be invariant, right? I mean, I could have even done worse thing. Instead of taking psi bar and psi at two ends, right? I could have taken chi bar at one end and psi at the other end. Okay, take two different sets of fields. Okay, and write down Lagrangian, which is initially chi bar I gamma mu del mu psi. And then make it covariant, okay, by replacing del mu by d mu, okay, chi and psi transformed by the same matrix U. It doesn't have necessarily Hermitian hermeticity property, right? Because psi will go to chi bar and psi bar and chi bar will go to chi. Okay? So you have to add the Hermitian conjugate term anyway. Okay? So hermeticity is not the issue, but nevertheless, you want to see what is the minimal number of fields that you want to that you can have.
I think I don't know. Probably, if we take S mu to be anti-Hermitian, probably it will work. Because
we'll see what
because,
what you have to
do. If you just you can write the first term to be same as I U del mu U inverse. So you can write this thing half of sum of this thing, and the second term is as it is. Now, if you apply the anti-Hermiticity condition, then S mu also gives S mu prime to be also anti-Hermitian.
Okay.
So, in that way, you can reduce the number of S mu.
Okay. So, that's one way to reduce the number of things. There may be other ways also, you have to check. Right? Yeah. Okay. So, given this, we have to now examine it and see what property you can impose, additional constraint. Right? But, first I want to emphasize that it's not necessary to impose those constraints. Right? Just like in QED. Okay. You could have gotten a Lagrangian, okay, where you have two gauge fields, A mu and B mu. Okay. Is that the B mu doesn't come, the field is not charged under B mu. Okay. You can always write a Lagrangian. So what you will find is in one case it couples to A mu plus I B mu, in the other case it couples to the Hermitian conjugate couples to A mu minus I B mu. B mu is nevertheless there is a field, but it just doesn't couple to the formula. Well, because you can impose a reality condition. That is the point. Okay? That you can, by looking at the Lagrangian, you can say it is consistent to impose that mu is real. Okay, just like we'll do it here.
Sir, in that case, that comes from the observation that.
Well, it comes from the observation that mu goes to mu plus del mu epsilon, right? So if epsilon is real, right? If you start with real mu, you will always get a real mu, right? But if you start with an imaginary mu, that is not enough, right? An imaginary mu will go to a sum of an imaginary part and a real part. Okay? So you have to impose the condition that mu is real, or you can impose the condition that mu is real. Okay? You can also choose to work with both components. Okay? Mu has a real part and an imaginary part. But it is not consistent, for example, to demand that mu is imaginary. Okay? Because then that is not inconsistent with this transformation. Okay? So it's similar here. Okay? The condition that you are going to demand, that is, that can be imposed, but it doesn't have to be. Okay? If it does, if you don't impose it, that means you are just introducing some additional fields which you don't really need for covariance. Okay, just like here, if you introduce A mu plus I B mu as your field. Right? The B mu part is not needed for covariance, right? The B mu doesn't transform. Is that point clear? No, not clear. Then in QED, if you see, add A mu plus I B mu, right? And use the transformation law that A mu goes to A mu plus del mu epsilon, B mu goes to B mu. That is a perfectly consistent choice which will make the covariant derivative transform correctly. Okay. And then you have to add its Hermitian conjugate. Okay, but the Lagrangian may not be Hermitian, that's something that you have to check. Okay. And then at the end of it, you will find that you have got a Lagrangian where B mu there is there as a field. Then you can also introduce its kinetic term, right? Some F B mu nu, F B mu nu. Okay. But that B mu doesn't couple to the original fields, right? The I B mu and minus I B mu just cancel out. That's the way you recover gauge invariance there. Right? Mu doesn't transform, mu transforms to mu plus ZB epsilon. Okay, so here, let's see what you can do.
If you take mu to be imaginary and epsilon to be imaginary, then it can be satisfied.
Yeah, but if you take epsilon to be imaginary, then the problem is that you have is equal to I epsilon, right? Psi was going to e to the I epsilon psi, right? And psi bar will use the fact that this goes to psi bar e to the minus I epsilon. Right? If you take epsilon to be imaginary, then this will not cancel. Okay, because this will not be e to the minus I epsilon, it will be I epsilon again, right? Because I epsilon is here. Okay, that's the analog of that we have already imposed that u is unitary. Right? U dagger u is identity. Okay, so with that, now the question is what can you do? Okay, so as Rishi said that it is possible to try to impose anti-hermeticity of SU. Well, hermeticity, I think it's hermeticity. We will see what it is. Okay, so let's calculate. Okay, suppose you don't know whether it's hermitian or anti-hermitian. Let's try one of them. Okay, S mu dagger is equal to plus or minus S mu. Okay, now let's try to calculate S prime mu dagger. So S prime mu dagger will be, okay, I'll write this as del mu u dagger. I think for this purpose, it is useful to write this as I del mu u dagger plus u S mu u dagger. So, u inverse is u dagger. Oh, minus, yeah. So S mu prime dagger will be I u del mu u dagger. Okay, I want to make the minus I into I, and then u comes here, del mu u dagger, and that becomes u S mu u dagger. This one doesn't fix whether it's Hermitian or anti-Hermitian. Right? We demand S mu dagger is minus S mu or plus S mu. This will also change side, so that is not going to be helpful, but this will determine. Okay, so let's look at that. So this one, I can use this fact that u dagger u or u dagger equal to 1. If you take a del mu of this, this should be 0. Okay, because u dagger is identity. So this gives you that del mu u dagger plus u del mu u dagger is 0. So the first term, then u del mu u dagger can be written as minus I del mu u times u dagger plus u s mu dagger u dagger. Is this clear? So you see that this has come back to the same form. Okay, minus I del mu u dagger. So you see that now if we impose that S mu dagger is S mu, then this becomes S prime mu. If we impose if S mu dagger is S mu, and similarly S prime mu dagger of course has to be S prime mu. Because once you impose a condition on some field, its transform better satisfy the same condition, right? Otherwise, it doesn't make sense to say that you are transforming the field. Is that point clear? That once you have imposed a condition on the field, you have already fixed, limited the number of components, right? So now you cannot transform into something which is not of the same form. So if we impose this, then this is perfectly consistent because it will tell us that this equation takes the form of S prime mu as minus I del mu u u dagger plus u s mu u dagger, which is exactly what we have here. S time mu is minus I del mu dagger plus U S mu dagger.
Is this clear?
So this says that it is consistent to impose the condition that S mu is Hermitian. So that cuts down the number of components. What is the number of components now? If it's n by n Hermitian matrix, it's still n square, but real.
Yeah.
Well, the point is that there are n times n minus 1 by 2 off diagonal ones.
Right.
Yeah, so those are the there plus n real ones, right? Now diagonal ones are all real.
Okay.
So you basically half the number of independent variables. Is that clear? Okay. N by n Hermitian matrix, right? You impose that A dagger is equal to A. So for the off diagonal elements, if you keep the top one, the bottom one gets fixed. So that's n into n minus 1 by 2 real component, complex components. That's n into n minus 1 real components. Right? And diagonal ones, there are n of them, but they are all real, right? For Hermitian matrix. So total number of real components in n into n minus 1 plus n, that's n square. Okay, you have basically half the number of degrees of freedom. Okay? So instead of using n square independent complex fields, you only have to introduce n square independent real fields. Is this clear? Now, this is all you can do if we want this theory to be invariant under the general n by n unitary matrix. Okay, which depends on the space time points. But often it is useful to put another restriction, okay, which is that we don't demand that the theory is invariant under an n by n unitary transformation, okay, but we demand that the theory is invariant under the n by n spatial unitary transformation. Okay. So spatial unitary transformation is transformation by U, which not only satisfies U dagger U equal to identity, but also determinant U equal to 1. Yeah, that's the definition of a spatial unitary transformation. So suppose we demand invariance under local. Okay, so local means that the matrix should be able to depend on space time points. Right? That's the meaning of a local transformation. So local SUN transformation instead of UN transformation.
So for UN, we cannot put further restriction.
For UN, you cannot do any further restriction.
That is a minimal one.
Yeah, this is a minimal one.
N square.
Yes, N square. Okay. But now we are trying to relax the conditions a little bit. Okay, instead of demanding that it's invariant under arbitrary local UN transformation, okay, arbitrary local n by n unitary matrix multiplication, we only demand that it's invariant under spatial unitary transformations. Okay. That can still be global transformations which are UN. Okay. But as far as the local transformation is concerned, okay, let's suppose that we demand only SUN, not UN.
So, physically, what that implies that why we are choosing SUN, not UN?
Only the theory can determine, nature can determine whether you should use UN or SUN, right? These are the different possibilities, right?
Okay.
SUN is a nice subgroup of UN,
yeah.
Right? If a UN locally factorizes into UN times SUN. So that's why SUN is often normally what one uses, right? You can always think of the UN as a product of SUN and U1,
yeah.
Right? And you do this separately for U1 as well as for SUN.
Can't we connect these to identity? Date U equals to unity.
Yes.
Means all the transformation connected to identity continually.
Yeah, so, but that is true for UN, but for SUN, it's
okay.
Much more constant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because in general, the determinant is a phase, right?
Yes.
It's not just plus minus one. Okay, so it's not just, you're not keeping only those identities. I mean, elements of un connected to identity, that those are still many more, right? Because the phase can be completely arbitrary. Okay, so SUN is really your going to remove one transformation parameter, right? Because any un matrix can be thought of as an SUN matrix times a phase. That is clear, right? Because you are multiplying a un matrix by a phase, you can make it into an SUN matrix, right? Just make the determinant one by choosing the phase appropriately. Okay. And in fact, it doesn't matter whether you multiply by that phase from the left or from the right, because that's the identity matrix, right? So it gives the same result. Okay. So that's the reason why we say that the UN is a product of SUN and U1. Okay. There are some subtleties with this, okay, but that's a global issue. As far as we are concerned for this analysis, you can think of UN as just a product group, okay, that you have separately SUN symmetry as well as U1 symmetry. Okay. And now we are saying that suppose you want to, we choose to give up the U1 symmetry, okay, but preserve the SUN symmetry local, okay, then what can you do? Okay, can you impose some further condition on this SUN?
Sir, so that actually implies that actually if you even take UN, so basically the U1 charge corresponds to the, all the fields within this SUN have the same U1 charge.
Yes.
So if you even construct the UN theory, you can do the SUN theory because all the charges of U1 charges of this thing are same.
Yes, because U1 and SUN commute, right? Mm-hmm. So that's the fact that all the n elements of the vector of psi will carry the same U1 charge. Is simply the statement that when you multiply the e to the I alpha, right, that commutes with multiplication by in any SUN matrix, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's just an overall phase, proportional to identity matrix, whether you write to the left or the right doesn't matter. Okay. So because it's a product group, it is guaranteed that all the components will transform exactly in the same way under U1. Okay, all the components of the vector field. Okay. But the reason that UN is not fully SUN times U1, has to do with more with global transformation, because there are some SUN elements and some U1 elements which are common. Okay. So for example, suppose you look at SUN, right? This matrix e to the 2 pi I by n e to the 2 pi I by n to e to the 2 pi I by n. This is an SUN matrix. Right? Because if you take the product, okay, determinant is the product of the elements, right? So this is one. So this is an SUN matrix, but this is also an U1 matrix. Right? So this element is common between SUN and U1. If you think of this as a UN group, right, this element can be either thought of as part of SUN or part of U1. Okay? But if you just take a product group, SUN times U1, okay, then the only element that should be common between the two is identity element. So because of this fact that this element in UN, this element can be thought of as either part of UN or SUN or as part of U1, makes it non-factorizable. The UN is not true, strictly product of U1 and SUN, but that distinction will not bother us for what we are going to do. Okay, so for whatever we are going to do, we can think of UN as just a product of U1 and SUN. Okay, and so now all you are saying is that we give up the U1 symmetry. Okay, local U1 symmetry, we only demand invariance on a local SUN symmetry. Okay, and see what we can achieve. Okay, whether we can reduce the number of fields even more.
I think this SU and SU bar, these are going to be anti-Hermitian because these are elements of the Lie algebra, and Lie algebra of UN is, I think, anti-Hermitian matrices and not.
Well, this is Hermitian, you saw. Minus I del mu u dagger is Hermitian, right? Because del mu u dagger is anti-Hermitian, but after you multiply minus I, right? This is really Hermitian matrix. Right? Unless there is some problem in the calculation that you have done,
no,
right?
It's correct.
Yeah, I think this is.
Because of I, it's Hermitian.
Yeah, because of this I, I think it becomes Hermitian.
Why in this case it is not a matter, it doesn't matter, this not non-equality between
Oh, it doesn't matter because you will be considering most of what you will be doing will be for infinitesimal transformers. Right? These are finite group transformers. Right? I mean, only at the level of finite transformations you see the difference. But for most of what you will do, this infinitesimal transformation will be able to get us there. Right? You don't really need the full finite transformation.
Can you comment on what is the global issue associated with
SUN
and
UN? This one is, when you think of a UN group, right? This is part of both U1 and SUN. Right? Whereas if you really think of a product group U1 times SUN, then they should have no common element. Right? Except the identity element. So that's the issue. That's the reason why UN is not strictly the product of U1 times SUN. Is this clear? Yeah? Okay. So now we have this transformation. And the claim will be that we can now impose a further condition that if U belongs to SUN, then we can impose trace of SUN. S mu was a matrix, right? If U belongs to SUN, this symbol is belongs to, right? So basically this means if determinant U is 1, right? That's all it means. So if you don't like this, this means determinant U equal to 1. Okay? So is this clear? What we have to show now? Right? So what you have to show now is that if we impose trace S mu equal to 0, then it better be that trace S prime mu is also 0. Right? Then this transformation will make sense, otherwise it will not. Is this okay? So let's check this. So trace S prime mu this is minus I del mu trace del mu u times e inverse plus trace of u s mu u inverse okay. Now this is of course easy to handle because you just take the u inverse on this side because trace has a cyclic property, right? So you take the U inverse on this side, so this becomes trace of S mu. This becomes trace of S mu, and that is 0. Is clear? This one is something you have to still verify. So to check that this is 0, we use this formula that trace log of u is log determinant of u. This formula is familiar to everybody. Then if you take a matrix u, right, you can check this by diagonalizing u. Right? Once you go to diagonal u, if you just diagonalize u, right, then you can easily check that this is true. Yeah, then you use the fact that the trace doesn't matter if you conjugate it by some matrix, similarly determinant doesn't care if you have gone to a diagonal basis. So now this one for determinant is equal to 1, this is log of 1 and that's 0. So now you take del del x mu on the right hand side raise log mu is 0. The derivative of 0 of course is 0, but this I can write as trace del del x mu of log of u, which is trace of u inverse del mu. Now this we can do because it's inside a trace. Okay, otherwise you have to worry about whether the u inverse would be on the left hand side or the right hand side. In fact, you have to take the symmetrized product, but because it's inside a trace, it doesn't matter whether you can write u inverse on the left hand side or the right hand side, it's the same. Okay. So this shows the trace of u inverse del mu is 0. Okay, so this is also 0. Is this clear? Not clear. Well, there is in fact another way of doing it.
So can we use this harmonicity property of S prime to something?
Yeah.
Once we have this trace S prime mu equals to this thing, and
yes,
then take S prime mu dagger and take its trace. So since they are same, and
yes,
so that part is actually a total del mu of
the point is unless u has determinant 1.
Yeah, means that we will use it. That we will have to
use. Why will you use it?
This, when we take this S prime u dagger and trace of that.
Yes.
And since S prime u dagger is S prime u,
mm-hmm,
we add the two equations. I think there'll be, when we add them, we will get a minus I trace of del mu of u dagger. So this whole thing. That will be good.
Okay. Yes.
So from that, we can put that trace. But that will use the harmonicity property of S prime u.
Yeah, but that is not using the determinant u property of u, right? The determinant u is equal to 1, that property you have to use somewhere.
Yeah, so inside the trace, I'm saying that it will come as del mu of u dagger units, this total.
Oh, I see. Yeah, so, okay, I understand what you're saying. So, this is, maybe that's what I want to say this. In fact, for this, you probably don't even need the harmonicity. Okay. You have del mu u times u inverse. So this is true, that plus u inverse del mu u. No, u del mu u inverse. Yeah. Okay, you can try various ways, right? But the point is, it shouldn't be such that without using the Hermitian, the determinant is equal to 1, you can prove this. So this is just one way of proving it, right? I leave it to you to find various other ways of proving this. But this is just a matrix relation that if u has determinant 1, then this is true. Okay, that the trace of del mu times u inverse is 0.
Sir,
yes.
These two conditions are independent?
Which two conditions?
And this trace of
u. Yes, these are independent because you could have chosen u to be unitary but not spatial unitary. Okay? Mm. In that case, you can choose S mu to be Hermitian but not traceless. So these are really independent conditions. Okay. If you demand u to be spatial unitary, then S mu can be chosen to be Hermitian and traceless. So you may still choose to keep the part of S mu which has a trace. Right? It just it doesn't transform under this transformation. So it is an additional field you are introducing for which is serving no purpose. Right? And the same thing is true for the anti-Hermitian part of S mu. Right? Nobody told you that you have to impose that S mu is Hermitian. Right? You could have kept the other part. Okay. Is there that other part? Doesn't take part in the transformation now. Okay. So just the Hermitian part is good enough to make a covariant derivative. Is this point clear? Okay. So with this then you have got this we have got d mu, the definition of d mu psi, which is del mu psi minus I s mu psi. Minus I s mu psi. And the Lagrangian or the action is now integral d 4 x by psi bar. This is invariant.
Is there a way to know this is the minimal one?
Yes, you can check that this is a minimal one. I'll not give that proof, but you can easily convince yourself that this is a minimal number that you need. Right? And that you can do by parameter counting. You see how many independent degrees of freedom are there in U. Right? And for each of those, you have to introduce a gauge field that compensates. Yeah, and you can show that way that this is a minimal number. That you cannot reduce the number anymore. Other questions?
Yes, the derivative you took of log u, suppose trace was not there, to then which way to keep this or that?
No, then you have to symmetrize.
Okay.
Right? That's what happens if you take a polynomial, for example, right? A to the n. Right? If you take dd x mu of a to the n, you have to fully symmetrize. Right? Where you put the derivative, right? So you have to do something similar here. But inside the trace, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Okay, so now let's try to see how to think of this as a set of independent fields. So you have got say this abstract notation, right? That S mu is a matrix variable field, so it's like an n by n matrix. But not all components are independent, right? That's what it is saying, right? Because the hermeticity condition and the tracelessness condition, some components of S of the matrix are actually the related to the other components, right? By some complex conjugation or by reality condition. But often it's more useful to choose a basis in which you think of this as n square minus 1 independent fields, real independent fields. And the way we do it, okay, so let me say this, that we will now focus on the SUN test from now on. If you want to use a UN, you just have to relax that condition. Okay, that you don't impose a traceless condition anymore. Otherwise, whatever I'm going to say would be valid for UN as well.
So that will be
n square instead of n square. Yeah, that will be n square instead of n square minus 1. So what we'll do first is we'll introduce a linearly independent set n by n Hermitian matrix. So these I'll denote by PA, where A runs from 1 to n square minus 1. So in n equal to 2, you already know what these matrices are, right? What are the linearly independent set of 2 by 2 Hermitian matrices? The Pauli matrices, right? The Pauli matrices form the linear independence of 2 by 2 Hermitian matrices, but you can traceless Hermitian matrices. Sorry, I should write traceless. So otherwise, even in for n equal to 2, you have the Pauli matrices, but there's also identity matrices, right? That has traceless. But you can, of course, do this for any n, right? So, for example, for n equal to 3, okay, you can start with something like 1 minus 1, 0, 1, 1 minus 2, then 0, 1, 1, 0. there are 4 of these, but you need of course 8. Like n square minus 1 for n equal to 3 is 8. You can easily construct other 4. Right? There will be 1 here, I minus I here. There will be 1 here, I minus I here. Right? Those are the 8 matrices. So given this matrix S mu, now I can write sum over A equal to 1 to n square minus 1 d mu A. So these are matrices. These are just fields, but no other components, right? These are just really numbers for every given x, mu and a. Okay, b mu a is just a number. It's regular fields. I have now made all the components of the fields manifest. Right? There's a hidden matrix structure anywhere. The matrix structure is here in T. Is this clear? So these are our new fields. But now if you want to deal with this field theory, we also need some kind of kinetic term for these fields. Okay? Just like for the electromagnetism, we could introduce A mu by covariantizing the Dirac action. Okay? But then we needed separately a Maxwell term, F mu nu, F mu nu term, right? Which is getting very invented. So we need some other term which will have at least a quadratic piece in B mu and perhaps something more that we will see, which should be gauge invariant by itself, because this is already gauge invariant, right? We don't want to do anything to this. We need now something which involves only the B mu's and is gauge invariant. So that's what we will try to construct. Is this clear? But before we do that, okay, let me just write down the transformation laws of B mu in a somewhat different fashion. So you remember S prime mu was minus I del mu u of x u inverse plus u s mu u inverse. And this was the transformation law of S. Now we want to convert this to something about the B's. So this tells us that B mu A, B prime mu A, TA, I'm just like writing S prime mu as B prime mu A TA, that's a transform P, will be given by minus I del mu u of x inverse plus B mu A. Again, I'll use the Einstein summation convention, so the repeated indices will be all summed over. So B mu A U is clear so far? Okay, I can write a sum over A, but it's not, I'll drop it for most. Now we are going to use the fact that this matrix that we have here, we had already determined earlier that this is traceless and Hermitian. And that's how this transformation law made sense anyway. So this is traceless and Hermitian. So if it is traceless and Hermitian, then minus I del mu u of x inverse, must be of the form, okay, I have just used plus, let me write this, but plus or minus of course doesn't matter. For some no, we have to put the summation sign on both sides at this step. Eventually you can remove TA, yeah, but not at this stage.
No, but S mu is a linear combination of independent fields.
Yes.
So you could just
multiply by matrices.
Yes.
Right? So this one, U TA U inverse, will become a linear combination of the TAs. Right? It's not TA itself. So this is a matrix. And after you have expressed this entire as a linear combination of the matrices, then you can try to compare the coefficients of TA on both sides. Right? But at this stage, you still have the full a matrix here, right? And a matrix here. Is this clear? So what the idea is that we will express both the left hand and right hand side just as linear combinations of the TAs, because TAs are the basis of Hermitian matrices, right? Traceless Hermitian matrices, and then you can compare the coefficients. Is this clear? So is this point clear? Right? Yeah. That this we know is a traceless Hermitian matrix. Okay. Minus sign, of course, it doesn't matter. If something is a traceless Hermitian matrix, minus of that is also a traceless Hermitian matrix. Right? Okay. So this is a traceless Hermitian matrix, and since TAs form the basis of traceless Hermitian matrices, a traceless Hermitian matrix can be writable as a linear combination of the TAs. And the coefficients of linear combination are what I am calling alpha mu I of x. Okay? These of course depend on what u x of you have chosen. Depend on u x. Is this point clear? Similarly, u p a, u inverse. If TA is traceless and Hermitian, then this is also traceless and Hermitian. Then we effectively use this now. Trace of this is the same as trace of TA. Right? And trace of TA is 0, because TA was traceless. The Hermitian conjugate of this, you write U TA U dagger. And the Hermitian conjugate will be again U TA dagger U dagger. If TA dagger is TA, then this is again the same. So this is traceless and Hermitian, this whole thing, if TA is traceless and Hermitian. Is this clear? So because it's traceless and Hermitian, I can write this as sum over B, PB times RBA of X. Again, this of course depends on X. The matrix is, matrix structure is purely in PB, this is just a set of numbers. Okay? The coefficient of a linear combination, it depends, the B is summed over and it depends on A of course, because on the left hand side, you had an A. Right? If you take a different TA here, you will get a different linear. Right? So that's why R depends on both B and A. Is this clear? So we will now substitute this here. to say that sum over u, p prime u, e, is given by minus plus sum over a and b. Okay. And now I can just rewrite this slightly by exchanging A and B. Exchanging. Now these are summation indices anyway, right? So. So using this, now we can compare the left hand side and the right hand side. Use the fact that the TAs are linearly independent Hermitian matrices, traceless Hermitian matrices, and hence the coefficient of each TA must agree between the left hand side and the right hand side. Okay, because the matrix structure now is fully inside TA. These are just constants. Okay, so we see that B mu A prime, B mu A prime has the form minus alpha mu A x plus sum over B. So this is the general form of the transformation law of the component fields B mu A. Of course, this is still very implicit because to determine alpha mu A and RAB, you have to go back to this formula, right? The definition of alpha mu A. Once you have given u, then you have to actually calculate alpha mu A and RAB from this formula. Okay, once you compute this from that formula, you substitute it here and you get the component form of the transformation law.
Questions?
Can you say anything about RAB? Right now? Well, we will say eventually. Right now, RAB is a set of matrices, NYN matrices, right, which is constructed by this formula. Okay. At this stage, all you can say is that RAB is real. Because if this is Hermitian, right, it's better to be a real linear combination of the Hermitian matrices. Right? So, this is real. Alpha mu A is also real, okay, because this is Hermitian, this is a real linear combination of the Hermitian matrices. And B mu A are real fields, right? I should have said this here. Right? When I have expanded this, right? S mu we know is Hermitian. Right? These are all Hermitian matrices, right? So this better be real. Right? So B mu A's are real fields. Whereas when you wrote in terms of S mu, okay, it has these various components. The components are not necessarily real. The off-diagonal ones are complex. Okay, it's just that they are related to by complex conjugation to the lower diagonal ones. Upper off-diagonal ones are related to lower off-diagonal components. But B mu A's are really real fields. Okay. So our goal now will be to construct the analog of the Maxwell action, okay, the F mu nu part. But this time for B mu A, okay, not for A mu. Okay? So the way we will try to construct the Maxwell action, okay, is what we described yesterday, somewhat indirectly, okay, that we need the analog of F mu nu. Okay. And if you recall, last time we constructed the analog of F mu nu by taking the commutator of two covariant derivatives, right? D mu d nu commutator, okay, contained in F mu nu, right? And that by construction was guaranteed to be gauge invariant, and so you could construct F mu nu, and that was a gauge invariant action. So the procedure that we are going to follow today will be similar to that. Okay. So for this, let's recall that d mu of psi, this was del mu minus I s mu on psi. Okay, I have now gone back to the s mu notation. Okay, eventually if you want to write in terms of d mu, you can always do it by expressing s mu in terms of. So d mu psi is del mu minus I s mu. Del mu minus I s mu psi. Okay, so let's try to evaluate this. So this is del mu minus I s mu on del mu psi minus I s mu psi. So this is. First, let's do del mu. So this is del mu psi minus I del mu s mu psi minus I s mu del mu psi minus I s mu del mu psi minus s mu psi.
This is the second term, still above, last expression, the first line, the first expression, just below that, this one, d mu,
okay. So this doesn't look very simple, okay, but we will take the commutator, okay, because you have seen that the commutator becomes simple. So d mu psi so you have to subtract from this the term where mu and nu gets exchanged, okay. And there you will see that many things cancel. For example, del mu psi and del mu psi are the same. Right? So this will cancel. This will not be there in the computer. This one will be there. This one cannot do much. Look at the sum of these two terms. Here it's s mu del mu. Symmetric under mu goes to nu exchange. Right? So these two will also cancel when you subtract the mu nu exchanged term. In the case of Maxwell's theory, this term also cancelled. Right? Because a mu nu, right? And we cancel it against a mu nu. But now that is not the case anymore because they are matrices. Okay, so this term you have to keep. So d mu psi then is minus I del mu s mu. Minus del mu s mu minus I s mu s mu. Put them inside brackets to just indicate that these are not going, these derivatives do not act on psi anymore. Right? All the derivatives have been explicitly expanded out, right? And this result is such that it's some matrix multiplying psi. Okay, no derivative on psi. Is this clear? So this is normally written, so we normally define that whatever is in the curly bracket as the field strength. So let's call this G mu nu. So we have in this position V mu, psi as minus psi G mu. But now let's see how we expect this to transform. Transformation law, d prime mu psi, psi prime. So d prime mu psi prime, how should it, what should it be? It should be u d nu psi, that's the way you have constructed the covariant derivative, right? So this is d prime mu on u d nu psi. That was the way we constructed the covariant derivative in the first place. Now what should this be? Again, you should come to the left, right? And d prime will be replaced by d mu. Because it's the same transformation, right? You're just multiplying up whatever is inside by u, right? And by construction, that whatever extra term you get from del mu gets cancelled against the S mu transformation law. So this is u d mu d nu psi. And the same thing is true for the exchange. D prime mu psi. D prime mu psi is again u d mu d nu psi. Is this clear? So now take the difference. This gives you d prime mu, psi prime, u, d mu, psi.
Mu.
Thank you. But now you see d prime mu, how does it differ from d mu? See, just by replacing s by s prime. Right? So whatever we did here, you could have replaced to d prime mu. All that will change is the S will be replaced by S prime. Okay? So I can write this as G prime mu nu psi prime as U G mu nu psi. Okay, but G prime mu nu is just G prime mu nu is the same as G mu nu with S replaced by S prime. But G prime is just an operator, a matrix, right? It has no derivative, differential operator. It has no differential operator inside G that acts on psi. That's why I put these brackets over here, right? All the derivatives of psi has already been explicitly done. Okay. So this then I can write G prime mu nu u psi as u G mu nu psi. because I prime is u psi. And this is true for any psi. Right? You have not made any assumption about what psi is. So this means that we must have g prime mu nu is equal to u g mu nu mu inverse. Well, I just script of psi. Right? Then g prime mu nu u is u g mu nu. I just multiply by u inverse from the right. Is this point clear? Now leave this as an exercise to check this explicitly. Okay, now what does it mean check this explicitly? Well, what it means is that I have given g mu nu, right here. I have told you what s prime mu nu is, right? S prime in terms of s, right? In terms of u's and so on. Just substitute s prime in terms of s. And you should be able to see that you get this transformation now. Okay, all the extra derivatives of s, etc. should cancel, and you should arrive at this. This is just a quick way of getting to the final result. But you don't need to know anything about psi to actually derive this, right? Because this is a property which involves only the gauge fields. Right? Psi is not entering anywhere in this relation. Right? Psi was just an auxiliary thing that we used to motivate why something like this may be useful. Is this clear? So given this, we can now try to construct a kinetic term, right? So what do you think the kinetic term should be?
Trace of
g mu nu g mu nu. See, earlier it was just f mu nu f mu nu, right? Mm-hmm. That is not going to work because first of all, g's are matrices, right? Action is not a matrix. Okay. Furthermore, it's not invariant. It has this u u inverse on two sides. Yeah? But if you take trace of g mu nu, that is good enough, right? So trace action can be taken to be proportional is of g mu nu. This is action for gauge fields. Okay, so next time we'll try to work out explicitly what g mu nu is in terms of the gauge fields. Okay, and then we can try to write this explicitly.
Transformation law of the g mu nu.
Yes.
This will hold in case of the u1 also.
Yes, it will hold for u1 also. Okay. Except that for u1, mm-hmm. if you put the u1 component of u, okay. that will actually commute with g.
I was going to say u n, if you don't impose that condition, trace of.
Yes, it will still hold. Yeah. It will still hold. Yeah. Okay, but that particular u1 part, which is the overall phase transformation, right, okay. that will just commute. Mm-hmm. Right. This may be a matrix, but definitely just coming through G.
Sir,
yes.
The trace like under the cyclic nature, the U will cancel, so this will be an invariant under U.
Exactly.
That's why this is guided by the invariant.
Yeah.
Is this trace the only invariant under the transformation that you can construct more?
For quadratic invariants. You can try to get other invariants involving hard parts of G.
In quadratic?
In quadratic form, this is the only invariant that you can. Right, for SUN.
Sir, one thing, you still not introduce the coupling term, right? Means when you have written d mu.
Okay, that comes in the coefficient of this term. I said action is proportional to this, okay. right? The coupling constant will basically come here, right? If you remember that for gauge fields also, right, there is one way I wrote the action, right, where the coupling term didn't come in the covariant derivative. Right? it was del mu minus E mu, sorry, del mu minus A mu or del mu minus I A mu, I don't remember what I used. Okay. And then I multiplied the action by 1 over E square. Right. So here also we will introduce a coupling that way. Okay. They are multiplying this by 1 over E square. Okay. Why that is the coupling will become clear as I discuss things in more detail. Okay. But otherwise there is no coupling here, for example, or in the reference of the covariant derivative. Yeah, that's the way I have introduced our S mu field. Right? Because S mu, I didn't introduce a constant in S mu.
And sir, why you are not introducing means, is there possible to epsilon mu nu rho sigma g mu nu 0 sigma in the action?
Yes, that's also possible. Right? But that again you can show is total derivative, right?
Okay.
That's like
in, the
like in the case of QVD.
Exactly.
What about
determinant?
Yeah, determinant will be higher powers, right? So you can, as I said, once you go beyond quantity quadrant, you can try to construct other invariants, right? But those will be, higher powers. Okay, so if you feel like an n by n matrix, its determinant is nth power of its elements, right? That's a big power. Okay, now one thing I can just say now that this G mu nu, okay, this is a simple exercise. You can check that G mu nu is Hermitian. And trace of G mu nu is equal to 0. Well, it's not very hard to see. If this is Hermitian anyway, right? S mu's are Hermitian, trace and traceless. Okay. So only non trivial thing is to check that this is Hermitian and traceless. Right? You can easily check the dagger, right? It's I will become minus I will become plus I. But Hermitian conjugate will basically exchange mu and nu. Okay, so you can easily check this is Hermitian and trace vanishes because this is commutator, right? So the trace will vanish. So this is Hermitian and traceless. So you can expand G mu nu as G mu nu times T sum over A. Right? So this G mu nu G mu nu can be written as sum over A and B, G mu nu, G B mu nu, trace of B A. And often people normalize these traces, okay, the TS. So far we have not said anything about how to choose the TS, right, except that they are linearly independent. Right? But often it's useful to normalize them so that this is delta A, proportional to delta A. Okay, so if this is proportional to G delta A, then the finite term can be written as G mu nu G B, G mu nu. Okay, up to a constant. Okay. Well, I have already chosen T's to be n by n Hermitian matrices, right? So there is a, I'm not even introduced any notion of representation, right? But yes, if you change the representation, then it will change. Okay, this is what is called the fundamental representation, right? I have been working so far, which is even the fundamental representation.
But the gauge fields are in adjoint
representation. Gauge fields will be in that adjoint representation. We have not shown it so far. Right? But once we understand the transformation of the gauge fields, it will be in that adjoint representation. Well, see, the gauge fields themselves are not in a, you cannot say it's an adjoint representation because it doesn't transform homogeneously. Right? There's this I alpha mu a.
Actually, G mu nu.
G mu nu will be in that adjoint representation. Yes. That you can also see, right? It's like U G mu, U G U inverse. Right? That is the property of an adjoint representation. Okay, so next time we will first So we write down GM UNU in terms of the beam UNs, because those are the fundamental fields. Right? So this relation that we have written, this is a matrix notation. Okay, we'll convert this in the component notation. Right? So GM UNU will be expressed in terms of the beam UNs. And then we'll study in more detail the gauge transformation properties of the beam UNs. Okay, so then we'll continue to